द वे फॉरवर्ड इज थोड़ा बहुत बहुत स्वागत है। मैं थोड़ा होस्ट हरजोत सिंह। पिछले दो हफ्तियां तो असी इस कंट्री विच ब्लैक हिस्ट्री अफ्रीकन अमेरिकन हिस्ट्री की गल कर रहे हैं। असी इस शो ते रेसिज़म दे कॉन्सेप्ट बारे गल की, असी स्लेवरी बारे गल की, हुण असी गल करन जा रहे हैं 1865 विच जद स्लेवरी US विच खत्म हुंदी है उस तो बाद ब्लैक्स नू इस कंट्री विच किवें ट्रीट किया जाता है, किवें जिहड़े नवी जिहड़ी एक लीगल सारी नवी एक रजीम आती है, क्या वह उन्हां दी सारी प्रॉब्लम्स खत्म कर देंदी है या नवी किस्म दी प्रॉब्लम्स उन्हां वास्ते क्रिएट की जाती हैं। असी गल कर रहे हैं हिस्टोरियन एक्टिविस्ट सरदार जयदीप जी नाल। जयदीप सिंह जी, थोड़ा बहुत बहुत स्वागत है।
सत श्री अकाल भाई जी, की हाल जी?
Jaideep ji, thanks once again for taking out the time, speaking with us on this important issue, educating us, our viewers. Asi, last time where we left off, we had just finished talking about, you know, abolition of slavery and entering into the reconstruction period. Asi apne viewers nu dassiye ki eh jehda takriban 12 saal da period hai ga, 1865 ਤੋਂ ਲੈ ਕੇ 1877 ਤੱਕ ਦਾ ਪੀਰੀਅਡ, ਇਸ ਨੂੰ US ਦੀ ਹਿਸਟਰੀ 'ਚ ਰੀਕਨਸਟਰਕਸ਼ਨ ਦਾ ਪੀਰੀਅਡ ਕਿਹਾ ਗਿਆ ਹੈ, ਜਿਸਦੇ ਆਪਣੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਹੋਰ ਕੁਛ ਯੂ ਨੋ ਐਲੀਮੈਂਟਸ ਆਉਂਦੇ ਹਨ ਜਿਨ੍ਹਾਂ ਬਾਰੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਵਿਸਤਾਰ 'ਚ ਗੱਲ ਕਰਾਂਗੇ। ਜੈਦੀਪ ਜੀ, ਪਲੀਜ਼ ਕੈਰੀ ਔਨ ਫਰੋਮ ਵੇਅਰ ਵੀ ਲੈਫਟ ਆਫ ਲਾਸਟ ਟਾਈਮ।
ਥੈਂਕ ਯੂ ਜੀ। ਸੋ ਆਈ ਥਿੰਕ ਵੇਅਰ ਆਈ ਲੈਫਟ ਆਫ ਲਾਸਟ ਵੀਕ, ਆਈ ਵਾਸ ਡਿਸਕਸਿੰਗ ਇਨ ਦ ਪੋਸਟ ਸਿਵਲ ਵਾਰ ਪੀਰੀਅਡ।
ਜੀ।
Black Americans were again betrayed by powerful white men in Washington, D.C. Mm-hmm. But the reality was the white power structure had to deal with the potential of black anger exploding, because in the wake of the Civil War, as I mentioned last week, blacks were angry and they were armed, and this scared whites. Mm. And so what ended up happening in this period was whites united against them. Conservative, progressives, that didn't matter. What mattered was the color of the skin, the race, or the racial line. So let me detail today the despicable depths of the conspiracy by white America against its former slaves.
Gee.
Now, as I quoted last time, I think I said, you know, there's a quote from President Lincoln. He said that, "I can hardly believe the South and North can live in peace unless we get rid of the Negroes. Certainly they cannot if we don't get rid of the Negroes whom we have armed and disciplined and who have fought with us. I believe to the amount of 150,000 men. I believe it would be better to export them all." So, during this time period, immediately after the Civil War, these soldiers, these former soldiers, these black soldiers were a particular target, both of the Union soldiers as well as the Confederates who hated them. Now, the Freedmen's Bureau said in 1866 that the new secret white terrorist organizations in Mississippi, like the Klan, the Ku Klux Klan, placed a special priority on murdering returning African-American veterans of the Union Army. Now, not only were these men less likely to bow down to public white supremacy, but black men in uniform obviously disproved the white supremacist claims of white inferiority. They weren't likely to say that to a black man with a gun.
Jaideep ji, main itthe point out karna chahanga, dekho saadi community vich particularly kyunki unhan naal saada exposure hunda hai, and we hear these ki bhai jehde kuch grievances hage against the you know African American communities, you know, people make all kind of aspersions, bhai lazy hai ke kam nahi karde, apni help nahi karna chahnde, jehde karde unhan nu te bhai society bada acha treat kardi hai. I want to, you know, lay particular emphasis on this point, as you pointed out, ki jis tarah clan hai oh unhan nu target kar reya siga, those blacks who served in the army. Now people who served in the army are seen as very respected people of the society. They are disciplined, they, you know, they have fought for the country, and that was their exact problem, that these people are disciplined and they're armed, they were not criminals. Is it right to say?
Absolutely. No, I think that's a really good assessment, and I think you're starting to see the same thing happening right now in Delhi.
Gee.
Where they're trying to discredit a movement for agrarian people by saying that radicals and violent people are involved with that movement. So, I mean, this is not a new tactic. It's what people in power always do. And I think that's an excellent point you brought up. So now, because these men were trained in the use of firearms, these soldiers, they also, many of them also own them. And as such, they were rightly viewed as potential leaders in insurrections or self-defense campaigns in the black community. Now, southern states reacted to this fear of armed black men during the 19th century by making it a crime for African Americans to own firearms. Now, this isn't something that happened just in the 1800s in the South. The exact same thing happened in the 1970s in my state, California, when Black Panthers entered the peacefully entered the California state legislature. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, this is certainly something that's happened throughout American history. I mean, the more you start to understand this, the more you start to see the same thing happening here and here again. Over, I mean, Malcolm X said that very clearly.
Jaideep ji, I'm sorry for, interfering with your thoughts.
No problem.
Again, so 1866, which just, on the 13th Amendment on the air, slavery abolition on the air, or 68, which 14th Amendment on the air, which makes them equal citizens, right?
Yes, I'm going to be talking about that in a minute. That's so important, Hanji.
So this thing that these they're not allowed to carry guns, does that happen before 68 or even after 68? Jehdi second amendment the rights ne unna tak nahi pahunchde.
Well, that's the whole point, is that before the Civil War, they didn't have access to guns. There was an enforced illiteracy, enforced disarming, all of these things. I mean, they kept blacks as a docile, disarmed, permanent slave, a permanent workforce. Mm-hmm. And that they didn't want that to change. They got rich off of it. Remember, I said that the Silicon Valley of the 1800s was the Mississippi River Valley. Mm-hmm. And that's where all the biggest and richest houses were. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't just targeting black veterans. There was a massive campaign after the Civil War to discredit black people, and in particular, these black veterans. White politicians and media sources were essential in the spread of racist hatred. Newspapers fanned the flames of prejudice with sensationalist stories that portrayed black veterans as participants in some kind of national race war. It was a myth. Local elected officials often worked hand in hand with the murderous mobs, giving the public advance notice of these planned killings. Everywhere, black soldiers were put in their place by whites. In New Orleans, for example, members of the U.S. 74th Colored Infantry were arrested as vagrants the very day that they were mustered out of the army. Everywhere in the occupied South, an emphasis was placed on defusing or wiping out the militia of the black masses. So in fear of mass black revolt, the U.S. government made peace with the rebels of the Confederacy. They stabbed the black people in the back. By the end of 1865, state governments were once again under the control of former supporters and leaders of the Confederacy. These men were able to reassert their dominance primarily because of the lenient pardoning policies of President Andrew Johnson. Now, Andrew Johnson had been a tailor. He had been the only Southerner who chose to remain in his seat in the U.S. Senate after his home state seceded from the Union. So he was rewarded by being placed as on the ticket as Lincoln's running mate. So when Lincoln was assassinated in April of 1865, Andrew Johnson became the president. Mm-hmm. So as president, Johnson believed that only the planters, right, the white planters possessed the experience and power to, quote unquote, control the volatile black population. And so he believed they were the best hope for the South. In May of 1865, he began the betrayal of black Americans by offering total amnesty to white Southerners, white traitors, who would swear basic loyalty to the Union. So you can see this pardoning power is not something that's just been a problem, in the last couple months. It's something historically that mm-hmm. essentially laid the groundwork for the undermining of democracy in the United States after Reconstruction.
Gee.
So the other thing he did, he gave amnesty to all the Southerners, blanket amnesty. He also allowed the Confederate states to be rapidly readmitted to the Union, encouraging them to organize state elections and reestablish their governments. So by the fall of 65, this was done. Now, what did this mean? This meant that many former Confederates were returned to high political office, and the new state governments immediately, as you would expect, passed legislation favoring the interests of planters and in direct opposition to that of black people. Mm-hmm. So what essentially happened was the white supremacist power structure in the South was allowed to reform. Now, among the most important laws that were produced at this time, and these are very important, are the Black Codes. This is a series of rigid labor control laws. Labor control, that's the key, because black people are labor. Mm-hmm. These are labor control laws that severely limited the freedom of black people. I mean, you don't want your cheap labor to get away from you. That's how you got rich. Mm-hmm. So this defined the status of black people as landless agricultural laborers. That's what they were. By law, they were landless agricultural laborers with no bargaining power and restricted mobility. They were restricted in the work they could do. In fact, they were also restricted in where they could meet, and even the gestures and remarks they could make to white people. And also, white people could still whip blacks with impunity. So, brother, what's changed? Immediately after, 4 years after, I mean, right after the Civil War, they put the exact same things into place. Now, these laws were designed in specifically allow them to target and punish any black person who stood up for themselves. That was the purpose of these laws.
So, 1865, which slavery khatam hondi hai, but black codes usno replace kar den, aur black codes ki das den ki tusi hali bhi kisi bhi black nu, you said ki usde upar haath utha sakde ho, maar sakde ho without any implication of law, and you control where they walk, who do they interact with, whether they can, you know, get together, form a union, ki wo kam kar sakde, and all these things are controlled.
So we're not talking about any kind of real freedom.
Ji,
right? We're talking
exactly
about a replacement for slavery being put in place by the white power structure. That's why when I talk about conspiracy, that's what I mean. So let me give an example of what I mean about why these laws were so much about targeting people who were independent and stand up for themselves. A freedman who was found without quote-unquote lawful employment could be arrested. Now, anyone can determine, any white person can basically determine if you have lawful employment or not. And so these were incredibly vulnerable people, open to all sorts of abuse of these laws. I mean, it's like the Dada laws from the 1980s. Anything you want to anyone, anytime.
Jaideep ji, I'll have to stop you here for a short break. Asi ek gal jari rakhange, ek choti ji break de baad. Tusi vekhde raho, The Way Forward. The Way Forward is toda fir tu swagat hai. Main toda host Harjot Singh. ਅੱਜ ਅਸੀਂ ਗੱਲ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਸਲੇਵਰੀ ਦੇ ਖਤਮ ਹੋਣ ਦੇ ਬਾਅਦ ਜੋ ਯੂ ਐੱਸ ਵਿੱਚ ਅਫਰੀਕਨ ਅਮੈਰੀਕਨਸ ਦੀ ਹਿਸਟਰੀ ਹੈ ਇੱਕ ਪੀਰੀਅਡ ਜਿਸ ਨੂੰ ਕਿ ਰੀਕੰਸਟਰਕਸ਼ਨ ਦਾ ਪੀਰੀਅਡ ਕਿਹਾ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਹੈ ਉਸ ਬਾਰੇ ਹਿਸਟੋਰੀਅਨ ਐਕਟੀਵਿਸਟ ਸਰਦਾਰ ਜੈਦੀਪ ਸਿੰਘ ਜੀ ਨਾਲ ਜੈਦੀਪ ਬ੍ਰੇਕ 'ਤੇ ਜਾਣ ਤੋਂ ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਬਲੈਕ ਕੋਡਸ ਦੇ ਬਾਰੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਦੱਸ ਰਹੇ ਸੀਗੇ ਪਲੀਜ਼ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਇਸ ਦੇ ਬਾਰੇ ਹੋਰ ਥੋੜ੍ਹੇ ਵਿਸਤਾਰ 'ਚ ਦੱਸ ਸਕਦੇ ਹੋ
So these were really important because these laws were an attempt to ensure that planters would have a permanent, immobile, and dependent supply of cheap labor. These black codes enraged the radical Republicans. This was a group of congressmen whose political roots lay in the anti-slavery movement. These were the true progressives. They sought a vast increase in federal power to obtain new rights for the freed people and to revolutionize social conditions in the South. This is what they were planning. Although they had a 3-1 majority in Congress, most were political moderates and not radicals. But even they were profoundly disturbed by the black codes and by the restored power of the ex-Confederates. In December 65, moderates joined radicals in refusing to seat the newly elected Southern congressional representatives. This action initiated a confrontation with President Johnson, and in the process, transformed the meaning and nature of Reconstruction. This conflict set the stage for radical Reconstruction, the most incredibly democratic blip of time in his, what is otherwise our nation's history of white racial tyranny.
Jaideep ji, tusi hun ek term use kiti hai, radical reconstruction. Can you elaborate a little bit, what was radical reconstruction?
Absolutely. So to me, this is the most important period in U.S. history. It was a brief 2 to 8 years, depending on which state, in which this country actually lived up to the glorious language in our country's founding documents. But it was destroyed far too quickly because it had to be. I mean, this is a fundamentally racist nation, so it had to be. Now, one of the first steps of this transformation occurred in early 1866. Congress passed a civil rights bill that conferred citizenship on U.S. on black people. This marked a dramatic break from the deeply rooted American tradition of states' rights and placed the federal government squarely on the side of extending citizenship and defending individual rights. President Johnson was outraged. He vetoed the legislation, but Congress overrode it. 3 months later, they overrode another veto of a bill that extended the life and power of the Freedmen's Bureau. So you're seeing Congress take over, and they're not going to be stopped by the president. So the radicals in Congress now sought an even more sweeping approach. They didn't just want civil rights. They wanted to totally transform society. But this didn't happen. The best they could do was, as you mentioned, they achieved the passage of the 14th Amendment, which, when approved in 1868, supposedly granted full citizenship to African Americans and prohibited states from denying them, quote, equal protection of the laws. Now, obviously, this wasn't the case. It's still not the case. But it was a tremendous, stunning transformation in the constitutional balance of power. Johnson told the Southern legislatures to reject the new amendment. So all the Southern states but his home state, Tennessee, refused to ratify the 14th Amendment. So we're at a point where the Union won the war, but they appear to be losing the peace. The fall of 1866 congressional elections became a referendum on the 14th Amendment and on Johnson's opposition to extending Reconstruction. As voters considered the issues, increasing anti-Black violence was reported throughout the South. In Memphis and Maine and New Orleans in July, local authorities stood by or actively participated as white Southerners slaughtered Black people. In the wake of this racist brutality, Republicans scored a landslide victory in November of 1866, and the biggest winners were the radicals. To achieve this victory for white political leaders, however, hundreds and hundreds of Black people died throughout the South. These heroes, they've been lost. Now, what happens is this election victory encourages the radical Republicans to present an even bolder agenda. That sweeping change they talked about, it's now coming. So each state was now required to hold a constitutional convention and to draft a new state constitution. They told every state that had seceded that you have to start, do a new convention. Yeah, and write a new constitution. African Americans protected by federal troops would participate in these conventions, and the new constitutions would include provisions for Black suffrage. Blacks would be allowed to vote. The act also required newly elected legislatures to ratify the 14th Amendment as a precondition for joining the United States again. Now, this guarantee of Black voting rights seemed to many Americans to represent the final stage of a sweeping political revolution. But in fact, it was just the beginning of incredibly radical change that was coming to the South.
Jaideep ji, you are talking about changes in the South. Jeda Reconstruction Act of 1867, that is kind of credited to have been a big instrument in causing that change in the South. Is that fair to say? And can you tell us something about that? That act.
Yes, absolutely. So the centerpiece of this radical Reconstruction agenda was the Reconstruction Act of 1867. It undercut the political and economic power of the planter class, and this is what's critical. It allowed true political activity among Black people for the first time, and this was it. Because in America, it's about democracy. It's about one vote, one person. If you have a majority of people, even if they're of a minority, I mean, if they're Black, they're the ones who are going to run the state. And this is exactly what came to pass. What happened was a massive and unprecedented movement of freed Black people into the political arena. Black people created union or loyal leagues, which helped build schools and churches. Again, they go right back to the schools again, Arjot. The leagues also organized militia companies to defend communities from ongoing white violence. They also called strikes and boycotts for better wages and fairer labor contracts. So they're trying to improve every aspect of their lives, their jobs, their homes, their religious community, their education. A number of local chapters were even organized on an interracial basis with both Black and white members. This is something that's never happened before in this country. And to this, it doesn't happen even today. To have real interracial unity in these political organizations, it's miraculous. So in the fall of 1867, Southerners began to elect delegates to the state constitutional conventions. And this is when it happens. The participation of freed Blacks was truly astonishing. It dwarfs what people do nowadays, and it shows how desperate Black people were for freedom and political power that allowed them some self-determination. Between 70 and 90% of eligible Black males, and again, only men were allowed to vote in this, right? Women weren't allowed to vote until 1919. But between 70 and 90% of Black men voted in every single state in the South. They elected 267 African Americans as delegates. For the first time in US history, Blacks and whites met together to prepare constitutions under which they would be governed collectively. The constitutions they produced were among the most progressive in the history of our country. They created social welfare agencies. They reformed criminal law, and taxation was more fairly distributed. Now, as you know, these are still issues that we're confronting today, right now. And they are still deeply tainted by race and white supremacy. The radical Republicans confronted them 154 years ago. And we don't know any of that history, and it's not an accident.
Jaideep, let me ask you something. You know, when we hear the word radical, at least in today's context, it has some negative connotations, right? Radical left, radical right, or whatever. So when we use the word radical for these reconstructionists, is it seen as a negative, somebody giving them this nomenclature, that they have done something negative for the society by giving rights to these black people? Or it's just that it was so revolutionary and it's seen in a positive sense? How is this word used here?
Absolutely. I think radical scares a lot of people, and it's because they're very comfortable with the way things are right now. But, you know, you and I come from a very different religious tradition. We come from a faith that was founded by a radical and by nine other radicals who completely altered the society they found around them. They rejected all these barriers of caste, of class, of religious difference. So to me, radical is something good, because if something is wrong, it needs to change right now and change very fast. Change very drastically.
And that's the way it has been used here, this radical word for reconstruction? That's the way.
Yeah, exactly. And so I think that's what needed to happen here. So as I mentioned, the black participation in politics completely transformed Southern politics, much like it did in election 2020. The only reason President Biden is president is because of black Americans. They saved us again. After 1867, the Southern Republican Party, with heavy support from black people, dominated all the new governments in the South. Black Americans captured a total of 600 legislative seats in Southern states. In South Carolina, they were a majority of the state legislature. Between 1868 and 1876, Southern states elected 14 black representatives to the U.S. Congress, 2 black U.S. senators, and 6 black lieutenant governors. Now remember, there are currently only 3 black senators in the U.S. Senate at this time, and only 11 have served in our nation's entire history. 2 of them came from this brief period. Equally important, thousands of African Americans served as local Southern communities, local Southern communities, as supervisors, as voting registrars, aldermen, mayors, magistrates, sheriffs and deputies, postal clerks, members of local school boards, and justices of the peace. So they were actually a part of society for the first time. They were part of the power structure to an extent. So I think this is I want to read you a kind of a long quote, but this is from a white supremacist who was Vangri Hanji. It won't be that long, like 2 paragraphs.
No, I will listen to that quote, but after break. After we'll speak about that on the other side of the break. The way forward is ਤੁਹਾਡਾ ਫਿਰ ਤੋਂ ਸਵਾਗਤ ਹੈ ਮੈਂ ਤੁਹਾਡਾ ਹੋਸਟ ਹਰਜੋਤ ਸਿੰਘ ਜੈਦੀਪ ਜੀ ਬ੍ਰੇਕ ਤੇ ਜਾਣ ਤੋਂ ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਰੈਡੀਕਲ ਰੀਕਨਸਟਰਕਸ਼ਨ ਦੇ ਸਾਰੇ ਪੀਰੀਅਡ ਬਾਰੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਦੱਸ ਰਹੇ ਸੀਗੇ ਪਲੀਜ਼ ਫਿਨਿਸ਼ ਯੂਰ ਥਾਟ
I want to give you a quote from a white supremacist propagandist named James Pike, who angrily reported on the state of government in South Carolina during Reconstruction. He said, "The members of the assembly issued forth from the state house, about 3/4 of the crowd belonging to the African race. Every Negro type and physiognomy was here to be seen, from the genteel serving man to the rough-hewn customer to the rice or cotton field. Their dress was as varied as their countenances. There was a second-hand black frock coat of infirm gentility, glossy and threadbare. There was a stovepipe hat of many ironings and departed style. There was also to be seen a total disregard of the proprieties of costume in the coarse and dirty garments of the field. The speaker is black, the clerk is black, the doorkeepers are black, the little pages are black, the chairman of the ways and means is black, and the chaplain is coal black. At some of the desks sit colored men whose types would be hard to find outside the Congo. It was not all a sham nor all burlesque. They have a genuine interest and genuine earnestness in the business of the assembly, which we are bound to recognize and respect." So what he's talking about is something that would be astonishing today, let alone 160 years ago. So this dramatic reversal outraged the Confederate masses, who saw their former property had now risen over them in their view. They quietly plotted their vengeance and returned to white supremacist power.
Jaydeep ji, let me ask you this. So, 150 years pehle assi a progressive agenda dekhiya, and you know, we see their involvement at all these levels. Other than for the black folks, how was it for the rest of the society, the poor of the society, you know, average workers? How did it work out for them?
When we talk about a radical revision of society, that's exactly what it was. And what that's going to do whenever it happens is help all of the poorest people in society. The liberal Reconstruction government swept away the social backwardness of the centuries in the South. They released modern reforms throughout Southern life. A public school system for the first time, integrated juries, state highway and road systems, protected labor reforms, divorce and property rights for women, and so on. So by giving blacks a voice, life for all Americans became better, especially the poorest and the most vulnerable. Now, again, this was a very short time, right? Only 2 years in Tennessee, 8 years in South Carolina. But in that time, the Republican governments made important economic and legal gains for all black and white working people. They created a public school system where none had existed. These schools, although they were segregated, were better in the cities and the countryside, were a huge symbol of progress compared to just recently they'd been mandated illiteracy. By 1876, half of Southern children were enrolled in school. Several radical governments also passed laws banning racial discrimination in public accommodations like streetcars, restaurants, and hotels. Now, the new laws also helped landless agricultural laborers, regardless of their race, both black and white, because these were the most financially vulnerable members of society. These laws gave farmers first claim on crops if their employers went bankrupt. I mean, that's nothing short of revolutionary. And the repeal of the notorious black codes enabled some black people to achieve their dream of land ownership. Now, this was the key. Remember, right at the beginning, they were talking about getting land. So by 1876, 14,000 families, black families in South Carolina, had acquired homesteads. So that's about one-seventh of the state's black population. Now, the problem was they were slightly more free. They were no longer slaves, but they were sharecroppers. And that is what we'll be talking about next when we talk about the shift to Jim Crow.
You know, Jaideep, we'll go into that later. But, you know, what I ask myself, and, you know, I want all our viewers to, you know, ponder upon this, कि अगर सारी सोसाइटी उस वेले बेनिफिट कर रही है, इट्स नॉट दैट कि ये जेडे रिसेंटली फ्रीड स्लेव्स हैगे ये बेनिफिट कर रहे हैं और बाकी जेडी सारी वाइट सोसाइटी है, पुअर सोसाइटी है, वो सफर किया उन्होंने. एज यू सेड, यू नो, एवरीवन्स लिविंग स्टैंडर्ड्स वर इम्प्रूव्ड, ऑल द यू नो एमिनिटीज इन द सोसाइटी, एजुकेशन, ट्रांसपोर्ट, एवरीथिंग, लेबर गॉट इम्प्रूव्ड. Then why was there a negative reaction to this time, these developments, and why did the Reconstruction end? What happened?
I think we can learn a lot about 1876 by looking at election 2020.
Gee.
You have the same situation in which the poorest white Americans in this country are voting for a party that's going to cut taxes on the rich and remove their safety net, and not even get them the vaccine they need to, you know, avoid dying. These people, if you look at, you know, in the whole middle of the country,
Donald Trump went by
20, 30, 40%. These people are voting for people who have their economic interest, who do not have their economic interests in hand. They're not voting their economic interests, they're voting their race. And that's the exact same thing that happened at that point. Wealthy whites appealed to racial solidarity, and poor whites accepted the compromise that, hey, I may live in a horrible tenement, you know, shack, I may have a horrible job, I may have rats living with me, but at least I'm not the N-word. And I think that's really important. The great author Toni Morrison said the first word of English European immigrants learned in this country was the N-word, because it showed them, again, I may have nothing in this country, I just arrived here, but there's somebody below me. And that was the compromise, the devil's pact that white Americans have been making, poor whites have been making since the birth of this nation, essentially.
You know, that's very profound, very interesting, but you know, something that needs a lot more introspection by all sections of the society. But jehda reconstruction da period hega, isnu ਖਤਮ ਕਰਨ ਵਿੱਚ ਦਿਸ ਅ ਫੀਨੋਮੀਨਾ ਜਿਸ ਨੂੰ ਕਿਹਾ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਹੈ ਦ ਕੰਪਰੋਮਾਈਜ਼ ਆਫ 1877. ਕੈਨ ਯੂ ਟੈਲ ਅਸ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਦੈਟ ਕੰਪਰੋਮਾਈਜ਼?
ਐਕਚੁਅਲੀ ਫਰਸਟ ਲੈਟ ਮੀ ਫਿਨਿਸ਼ ਅਪ ਜਸਟ ਵਨ ਲਾਸਟ ਥਿੰਗ. ਸੋ ਦ ਥਿੰਗ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਰੀਕਨਸਟਰਕਸ਼ਨ, ਇਟ ਹੈਡ ਟੂ ਐਂਡ ਬਿਕਾਜ਼ ਇਟ ਵਾਸ ਇਟ ਵਾਸ ਇਟ ਵਾਸ the thing about it was it's impossible contradictions. Hmm. It's completely went against the structure, the history, and the white supremacist nature of U.S. society. It could only have been temporary before white races clawed back their power. And so it did end. So the way it ended essentially was, you know, blacks were betrayed. Blacks betrayed by the white power structure. And so the compromise of 1877 ended Reconstruction. This was the final accommodation between Northern capitalists and the Southern planter class. In the 1876 presidential election, Democrats were on the verge of victory. Their candidate, Samuel Tilden, captured the majority of the popular vote, and he won the Electoral College as well. But in a foreshadowing of election 2000, Republicans backed Rutherford B. Hayes. They disputed the returns in Louisiana, South Carolina, and Florida, and threw the election into question. So we had a constitutional crisis. And of course, the business community is scared, and so they forced a compromise. In February of 1877, just a few weeks before the new president was to be inaugurated, pressure from businessmen and politicians forced a resolution to the conflict. In the compromise of 1877, the Democrats yielded the presidency to Hayes. In exchange, they received several federal-level government appointments, including at least one Southerner to Hayes' cabinet. They also received the green light to do whatever they wanted in the South. Mm-hmm. Essentially, the South promised to accept the dominance of the Northern capitalists over the country in return for regaining regional dominance over the South and African Americans. They abandoned them. Central to this was the withdrawing of the last occupying Union troops so the Klan could take care of African Americans as they wished. While the guarded remnants of Reconstruction held out here and there for some years, the critical year of 1877 marked their conclusive defeat. Now, I wanted to actually, I have a section, the question you just asked, actually I have a section where I answer what you just said. So actually, we can keep going. But I mean, again, when you look at, you know, why did poor white people vote for Trump? I mean, this is the great white supremacist paradox in this country that limits the organizing power of the masses of exploited, increasingly overworked, and increasingly economically desperate workers. Mm-hmm. And that's regardless of race. So instead of voting in people who help their families, poor whites repeatedly vote to aid corporations and the wealthy who screw them over even more, even in the midst of this pandemic. So, I mean, how can you move forward when you can't reason with people? It's kind of, it's like I said, the great American white supremacist paradox.
Jaideep ji, you know, when you say something so conclusively about an issue like this, at least in the present context, you know, there might be some other arguments to that as well. You know, which at least, you know, we appreciate in the present context, but I don't know what was the reality at that time. At that time, the race might have been the on the only reason. I don't know what else could
absolutely
be the reason.
Absolutely. If you look at the people who invaded the Capitol, it wasn't people of color. They stayed home. Mm-hmm.
But Jaideep, there are other factors, you know, working as well. So I don't know if they feel that there's a government who, you know, is aligning with somebody and have cheated, you know, off the people have been cheated, and somebody has told them that, you know, there's a fraud which they believe. So they, in their minds, are doing a duty towards the nation. I don't know if there's a race element to it, but that's
but what
a
I'm saying
debate.
Is, if Barack Obama had done this thing, no one would have done it.
That's a different debate. We'll keep it for a different time. We are trying to understand that the time of the history.
And I'm
what you're saying has merit. ਅਸੀਂ ਉਸ ਸਾਰੇ ਪੀਰੀਅਡ ਨੂੰ ਵਿਜੁਅਲਾਈਜ਼ ਕਰਨ ਦੀ ਕੋਸ਼ਿਸ਼ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ, ਸਮਝਣ ਦੀ ਕੋਸ਼ਿਸ਼ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ, ਸਾਡੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਵਿਊਅਰਸ ਹਨ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਸਾਹਮਣੇ ਇਹ ਲੇ ਕਰਨ ਦੀ ਕੋਸ਼ਿਸ਼ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਕਿ ਉਸ ਵੇਲੇ ਕੀ ਹੋ ਰਿਹਾ ਸੀ, ਸਾਨੂੰ ਪਲੀਜ਼ ਥੋੜ੍ਹਾ ਜਿਹਾ ਦੱਸੋਗੇ ਕਿ ਵੋਟ ਕਾਇੰਡ ਆਫ ਜੋਬਸ ਵਰ ਯੂ ਨੋ ਦ ਬਲੈਕ ਪੀਪਲ ਐਟ ਦੈਟ ਟਾਈਮ ਇਨਵੋਲਵਡ ਇਨ. ਤੁਸੀਂ ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਦੱਸਿਆ ਸੀਗਾ ਕਿ ਵੈਨ ਪੀਪਲ ਯੂ ਨੋ ਕੇਮ ਆਊਟ ਆਫ ਸਲੇਵਰੀ, most of the skilled jobs in US, particularly in the South, were with the blacks. Jaideep ji, assi ek continue karange ek choti ji break de baad. Tusi vekhte raho the way forward. द वे फॉरवर्ड इज ਤੁਹਾਡਾ ਫਿਰ ਤੋਂ ਸਵਾਗਤ ਹੈ ਮੈਂ ਤੁਹਾਡਾ ਹੋਸਟ ਹਰਜੋਤ ਸਿੰਘ ਜੈਦੀਪ ਜੀ ਬ੍ਰੇਕ ਤੇ ਜਾਣ ਤੋਂ ਪਹਿਲਾਂ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਇਹ ਗੱਲ ਅਸੀਂ ਸ਼ੁਰੂ ਕੀਤੀ ਸੀ ਕਿ ਇਹ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਪੀਰੀਅਡ ਹੈਗਾ ਰੀਕਨਸਟਰਕਸ਼ਨ ਦਾ ਸਲੇਵਰੀ ਖਤਮ ਹੋਈ ਹੈ ਲੋਕ ਰੀਸੈਂਟਲੀ ਫਰੀ ਹੋਏ ਹੁਣ ਨਾ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਸਿਟੀਜ਼ਨਸ਼ਿਪ ਵੀ ਮਿਲ ਗਈ ਹੈ 68 ਵਿੱਚ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਕੁਛ ਮਤਲਬ ਹੋਰ ਪ੍ਰੋਟੈਕਸ਼ਨ ਵੋਟਿੰਗ ਰਾਈਟਸ ਵੀ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਮਿਲ ਗਏ ਅਤੇ ਕਿਨ ਕੰਮਾਂ ਵਿੱਚ ਇੰਗੇਜ ਸੀਗੇ ਉਸਲੇ ਬਲੈਕਸ ਆਈ ਸੇ ਦਿਸ ਪਰਟੀਕੁਲਰਲੀ ਬਿਕੋਜ਼ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਦੱਸਿਆ ਸੀਗਾ ਕਿ ਜਦ ਇਹ ਪਹਿਲੇ ਫਰੀ ਹੋਏ ਸਲੇਵਰੀ ਦੇ ਦੌਰਾਨ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਮੈਕਸੀਮਮ ਸਕਿਲਡ ਲੇਬਰ ਸੀਗਾ ਸਾਊਥ ਵਿੱਚ ਪਰਟੀਕੁਲਰਲੀ ਦੈਟ ਵਾਜ਼ ਬਲੈਕ ਸੋ ਹੁਣ
ਉਹ ਈਵਨ ਡੂਰਿੰਗ ਸਲੇਵਰੀ ਈਵਨ ਡੂਰਿੰਗ ਸਲੇਵਰੀ
ਜੀ ਜੀ ਤੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਦੱਸੋਗੇ ਕਿ ਹੁਣ ਉਹ ਕਿਨ ਜੌਬਸ ਵਿੱਚ ਇੰਗੇਜ ਸੀਗੇ
ਐਬਸੋਲੂਟਲੀ ਸੋ ਵੀ ਆਰ ਟਾਕਿੰਗ ਅਬਾਊਟ ਦ ਕੰਪਰੋਮਾਈਜ਼ 1877 ਐਂਡ ਸੋ ਦਿਸ ਇਜ਼ ਰੀਲੀ ਦੀ ਫਾਲ ਆਫ ਰੀਕਨਸਟਰਕਸ਼ਨ ਆਈ ਥਿੰਕ ਇਟਸ ਇੰਪੋਰਟੈਂਟ ਟੂ ਲੁੱਕ ਐਟ ਆਫਟਰ ਦਿਸ ਵਾਟ ਹੈਪਨਡ ਟੂ ਬਲੈਕ ਪੀਪਲ ਐਂਡ ਬਾਈ ਡੂਇੰਗ ਦਿਸ ਯੂ ਕੈਨ ਰੀਲੀ ਸੀ ਹਾਊ ਦ ਚੇਂਜਸ ਕੇਮ ਅਬਾਊਟ
ਜੀ
ਨਾਓ what this compromise did was cement the rule of white supremacy in the south it made the region safe for northern businesses to invest consequently when the depression of the 1870s lifted northern businessmen started investing large sums of money in the south they saw an opportunity to make some money northern business interests were invited to invest by a new group of southern leaders who hoped to gain access to northern industrial wealth men like henry grady who was the editor of the atlanta constitution envisioned a new south filled with cities immigrants, commerce and industry, all financed by northern money. Now these signs of quote-unquote progress could be seen in the rise of cities in the south and the proliferation of factories for the first time in the south. Now the pride of this new south's manufacturing was its textile and its iron production. Now, obviously the most important industry and the key to southern industrialization was cotton manufacturing. Now during this economic boom time, Blacks were drawn into the factories and the mills of the New South. However, they were systematically excluded from entire industries like textiles. Remember, I just said textiles was the powerhouse technology for the South. This is actually the ugly origin of labor unions in the US. They were actually formed to exclude black people from entire industries and reserve the best jobs for whites only. That's in every state in this country except mine in California. The reason is because in this state, it was Chinese labor that built California. And so unions were actually targeting Chinese in California. So it's kind of the, you know, whatever non-white virtual slaves they use, they then target. Even worse, they were pushed out of the skilled occupations that they had previously dominated, black people. Let me explain what I mean. After the fall of Reconstruction, Southern whites benefited directly from the forced expulsion of African Americans from industry and the skilled trades, jobs that blacks had dominated prior to the war. The change was rapid and devastating to the black community. While roughly 80% of all skilled workers in the South had been African American in 1868, 32 years later, by 1900, those proportions had reversed. Only 20% of skilled labor in the South was black. In the more localized construction trades, black people hung on, barely. Their expertise was desperately needed because they couldn't be easily replaced. I mean, you don't want me, an historian, building your house, right? Even if I'm the right color. You want people who can build homes to do that. But in desirable mechanical trades that were created during this rising industrial revolution, black people were systematically excluded by whites. And this is very important for us to understand because it was this period that this discrimination and these structures of discrimination were put in place. Mm-hmm. So that when Sikhs arrived in the 1960s, they faced the exact same thing. Actually, when they faced them in the 1910s and 1920s. You must know the first congressman of South Asian descent, Dr. Dalip Singh Son. Mm-hmm. He earned a PhD in mathematics from UC Berkeley. Do you know what job he got with that PhD from the finest public university in the country? Mm-hmm. He became the head of a lettuce picking gang.
I'm sorry, say that again?
He became the head of a lettuce picking gang.
Gee.
Hmm. He went into farm work. Not a farmer. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's Sikhs were affected by these structures. This was the period that these structures were put in place by white people, and they continue to this day.
Gee.
Whites still dominate the most powerful and important professions in this country. Look at the media. Look at the president. Look at the Congress. Mm-hmm. What happened in the 1860s set the stage for 2020 is what I'm trying to say. And so that's why this period is so important.
And we realize that, you know, there are added protections with the Civil Rights Act, you know, with 1860s. Before that, there weren't those laws, so it would be easy to discriminate.
Well, what's scary is, I mean, if you look at the numbers, things really haven't changed much in the last 50 years in terms of actual percentages. Whites still dominate all the most powerful professions. And I mean, do you even imagine an airplane pilot as someone other than a white man in this country, the way we've been socialized by society? So I'm just saying, it's when you see someone other than a white man flying a plane, it's kind of shocking. So, and Malcolm X said this in the 1960s, and I'm saying this in the 2020s. So, I mean, that's how little has changed. So let's talk about blacks. So blacks were excluded systematically from all the new trades that were rising in the Industrial Revolution. On the Southern Railroads, black people had once predominated. And as late as 1920, they still accounted for 20 to 25% of all firemen, brakemen, and switchmen. But that changed as well. In 1911, the Atlanta Agreement between the railroads and the AFL Railroad Brotherhoods Union provided for the gradual replacement of all blacks by whites. Now, nonetheless, black people became an important source of industrial labor, although they continued to be employed primarily in agriculture. In 1890, 6% of the total black workforce was employed in manufacturing, compared to 19% of the native white workforce. From 1890 to 1910, the number of black male workers in non-agricultural occupations increased by 2/3 to 400,000. So they were allowed to move out of just, you know, sharecropping. But not really. I mean, this was mainly due to the expansion in sawmills, coal mining, and railroad construction. These were all dangerous, arduous labor. So what we're seeing is whites continuing to use black labor to build their country and develop their nation while simultaneously keeping all the benefits of that progress for themselves. Now, if you look at these mills, these industrialized mills in the South, in sharp contrast to the North, where the workforce was primarily immigrants, virtually all the Southern textile mill labor force was white and U.S. born, because blacks were simply banned. As discussed earlier, race provided Southern employers with a powerful weapon to divide their workers. As a rule, white workers tolerated exploitation more willingly if black workers were even worse off. So in most Southern industries, black workers labored separately from white workers, and they were relegated to the lowest paying and the least skilled jobs. They did the worst jobs, earned the least money, because whites forced them to do so. Mm-hmm. And if you study society, things really haven't changed all that much even today. Now, white people of all classes, this is very important, understood the privileges of white supremacy, and they fought to keep things that way. For instance, in 1898, the good white women in an Atlanta mill showed their determination to protect textile work as a white privilege when 1,400 of them struck to prevent the employment of two African-American women. White people understood their privileges and they fought to keep them that way. None of this happened by accident. Because of the vast discrimination against black men, black women were forced to labor outside of the household. The vast majority of urban black women toiled by day as maids in white people's homes, or they did laundry for pay in their own homes. They tended to reject live-in domestic work because its round-the-clock demands and surveillance were far too reminiscent of what they endured during slavery. Mm-hmm. Still, the point we need to take away is the blood, sweat, and tears of black people allowed generations of 20th century white people to maintain a conquest lifestyle of comfort and ease.
Jaideep ji, I take your point. You know, we don't have too much time left. There's another important development during this time, which I would like you to, you know, throw some light on. That is the coming up of those Confederate statues. It happens during this time. Can you tell us something about that?
Well, I mean, yeah, absolutely. I think we missed that earlier. Basically, the point is that after Reconstruction, the white power structure was reestablished, but black people could still vote. That's how they got all those people into Congress. So what we didn't talk about, unfortunately, is the main thing that destroyed Reconstruction was white terrorism. They beat people. They killed them. They murdered people who tried to vote. And by disenfranchising black people, that's when we saw the emergence of what we're going to talk about next week, which is the Jim Crow era of segregation, of legally mandated segregation. And that is the period in which, as black people were removed from the body politic, they were no longer part of the power structure. Right? We talked about they were aldermen, they were mayors, they were in the local power structure. by this point, in the 1890s, and by 1900, they'd been removed. It was at this point that all of these Confederate statues we see all over the country that went down last year were put up. There was nothing innocent. They weren't. This was 50 years after the end of the 40 years after the Civil War ended, some even later. The point was these were terrorist tools to daily terrify black people and remind them that if they didn't stay in their place, they'd be put into their place.
Mm-hmm. So, the argument
so there's nothing innocent about any of these statues. I think that the more you learn about the history, you learn there's nothing innocent about these representations.
So these statues, they are not what they say, history. It's not about their preserving their history. It's about, giving a signal to the black people. That's what you're saying.
Yeah, I mean, if this was about preserving the history, it would have been done in the 1860s, 1870s, 1880s. This was done in the 1900s mostly.
Jaideep ji, as we said, topic jada, it needs time. Today we have run out of time, and we will have to continue this. Asi agle hafte ਇਹ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਇਹ ਡਿਸਕਸ਼ਨ ਹੈ ਇਸ ਨੂੰ ਅੱਗੇ ਲੈ ਕੇ ਜਾਵਾਂਗੇ ਅਸੀਂ ਅਰਾਊਂਡ 1900 ਤੱਕ ਪਹੁੰਚ ਗਿਆ ਇੱਕ ਬੜਾ ਇੰਪੋਰਟੈਂਟ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਐਸਪੈਕਟ ਹੋਰ ਜਿਹਦੇ ਬਾਰੇ ਗੱਲ ਕਰਨੀ ਹੈ ਉਹ ਹੈਗਾ ਜਿਮ ਕਰੋ ਦਾ ਪੀਰੀਅਡ ਇਹ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਸਾਰਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਇਹ ਸਾਰੀ ਹਿਸਟਰੀ ਦੀ ਗੱਲ ਕਰ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਆਪਣੇ ਵਿਊਜ਼ ਨੂੰ ਇਹ ਦੱਸਣਾ ਚਾਹ ਰਹੇ ਹਾਂ ਕਿ ਅੱਜ ਅਗਰ ਕੋਈ ਸਿਚੁਏਸ਼ਨ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਵੇਖਦੇ ਹੋ ਉਸਦੀ ਕੁਛ ਵਜਾਵਾਂ ਹੈ ਉਸਦੀ ਕੁਛ ਹਿਸਟੋਰੀਕਲ ਬੈਕਗਰਾਊਂਡ ਹੈ ਸਾਡੇ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਇਸ ਸੋਸਾਇਟੀ ਨੂੰ ਸਮਝਣ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਉਸ ਹਿਸਟਰੀ ਨੂੰ ਸਮਝਣਾ ਬਹੁਤ ਜ਼ਰੂਰੀ ਹੈ ਉਸ ਬੈਕਗਰਾਊਂਡ ਨੂੰ ਸਮਝਣਾ ਬਹੁਤ ਜ਼ਰੂਰੀ ਹੈ ਜਿੱਦਾਂ ਜੈਦੀਪ ਜੀ ਨੇ ਕਿਹਾ ਕਿ ਜਦ ਵਾਰ ਖਤਮ ਹੋਈ ਹੈ ਅਤੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਸੋਲਜਰ ਸੀਗੇ ਅਤੇ ਕੁਛ ਵਾਈਟ ਸੁਪਰਮਿਸਟ ਇਸ ਚੀਜ਼ ਤੋਂ ਅਲਾਰਮ ਸੀਗੇ ਕਿ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਸੋਲਜਰਸ ਹੈਗੇ ਇਹ ਟ੍ਰੇਨਡ ਹਨ ਇਹ ਡਿਸਿਪਲਿਨਡ ਹਨ ਇਹ ਸੋਸਾਇਟੀ ਵਿੱਚ ਇੰਟੀਗ੍ਰੇਟ ਕਰ ਸਕਦੇ ਹਨ ਅਗਰ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮ ਇਹ ਹੁੰਦੀ ਕਿ ਬਈ ਇਹ ਬੰਦੇ ਐਫਰਟ ਨਹੀਂ ਕਰਨਾ ਚਾਹੁੰਦੇ ਇਸ ਕਰਕੇ ਦੇ ਵਰ ਟੂ ਬੀ ਲੈਫਟ ਬਿਹਾਈਂਡ ਅਤੇ ਫਸਟ ਪੀਪਲ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਜਿਨ੍ਹਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਮਾਰਿਆ ਜਾ ਰਿਹਾ ਸੀਗਾ ਜਿਨ੍ਹਾਂ ਉੱਪਰ ਅਟੈਕ ਕੀਤਾ ਜਾ ਰਿਹਾ ਸੀਗਾ ਉਹ ਸੋਲਜਰਸ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੁੰਦੇ ਅਗੇਨ ਜਿਵੇਂ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਜੈਦੀਪ ਜੀ ਨੇ ਦੱਸਿਆ ਕਿ ਅਰਾਊਂਡ ਦ ਐਂਡ ਆਫ ਦ ਸਲੇਵਰੀ 80% ਜਿਹੜਾ ਸਕਿੱਲ ਲੇਬਰ ਸੀਗਾ ਉਹ ਵਾਈਟ ਸੀਗਾ ਬਟ ਅਗੇਨ ਬਾਏ ਡਿਜ਼ਾਈਨ ਬਟ ਇਨ ਦ ਨੈਕਸਟ 30-35 ਈਅਰਸ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਸਕਿੱਲ ਲੇਬਰ ਇਸ ਕੰਟਰੀ 'ਚ ਬਲੈਕਸ ਵਿੱਚ ਰਹਿ ਗਿਆ ਦੈਟ ਵਾਜ ਲੈਸ ਦੈਨ 20% ਯੂਨੀਅਨਸ ਜਿਹੜੀਆਂ ਬਣਾਈ ਗਈਆਂ ਉਹ ਯੂਨੀਅਨ ਇਸੇ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਬਣਾਈ ਗਈ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਬਲੈਕਸ ਨੂੰ ਇੰਪਲੋਏ ਨਹੀਂ ਕੀਤਾ ਗਿਆ ਨਹੀਂ ਕੀਤਾ ਜਾਏ ਅਸੀਂ ਇਹ ਜਾਰੀ ਰੱਖਾਂਗੇ ਜੈਦੀਪ ਜੀ ਸਾਡੇ ਨਾਲ ਇਸ ਇੰਪੋਰਟੈਂਟ ਇਸ਼ੂ 'ਤੇ ਗੱਲ ਕਰਨ ਦਾ ਤੁਹਾਡਾ ਬਹੁਤ ਬਹੁਤ ਸ਼ੁਕਰੀਆ
ਮਾਈ ਪਲੇਜ਼ਰ
ਤੁਸੀਂ ਵੇਖਦੇ ਰਹੋ ਦ ਵੇ ਫੋਰਵਰਡ